The life of Christ is the greatest story ever told. We need to know who Jesus is, what he taught, how he lived, and what he promised. In this seventh lesson, we shall look at the study of the life and ministry of Christ, period 6 and 7. Period 6, the last week of Jesus' ministry, Passion Week. This week begins with Palm Sunday and ends with Resurrection. Passion means strong feelings. The week is called Passion Week because the events that took place were strong feelings of joy and later of agony and extreme suffering. The events in this period include 1. Mary's anointing, John chapter 12, verses 1 to 8. The time for the end of Jesus' life was quickly coming to an end. For him to come to Jerusalem for the Passover was an act of the highest courage. It was only 6 days to the Passover. He decided to visit the home of Martha, Mary, and Lazarus again. Mary's heart ran over in love. She had a pound of very precious ointment. With this perfume, she anointed Jesus' feet. Even though Judas Iscariot complained, Jesus silenced him by saying that the money could be given to the poor at any time, but a kindness done to him must be done now, for soon the chance would be gone forever. This showed Mary's love, dedication, and reality to the Lord. We see love's extravagance. Love is not love if it nicely calculates the cost. Like it is said that it is impossible to love without giving. Mary took the most precious thing she possessed and spent it all on Jesus. This is an act of submission and servanthood to the Lord. It was a sign of honor to anoint a person's head, but Mary would not look so high as the head of Jesus. She anointed his feet. The last thing Mary thought of was to confer an honor upon Jesus. She never dreamt she was good enough for that. But her lovely deed became the possession of the whole world and adds to the beauty of life in general, something which time cannot ever take away. This story reminds us of one great truth about life. Some things we can do almost any time, but there are some things we will never do unless we grasp the chance when it comes. It was possible that Mary was preparing Jesus' body for burial because such a time was not going to be there when it would eventually come. To show her heart's devotion to Jesus, this had to be done before the cross on Calvary took him to its cruel arms. Let us remember to do things now, for the chance so often never comes again, and the failure to do them, especially the failure to express love, brings bitter remorse. Mary's act may have happened either on Friday or Saturday, just before Jesus' triumphant entry into Jerusalem. It is important to note that this is not the Mary mentioned in Luke 6 as a sinful woman. 2. The triumphal entry. It was Passover time, and Jerusalem and the whole of the surrounding neighborhood was crowded with pilgrims. It was a law that every adult male Jew who lived within 20 miles of Jerusalem must come to the Passover. Jews from every corner of the world also made their way to this greatest feast of their national festival. Jesus could not have chosen a more dramatic moment to his last entry into Jerusalem than this. It was something which he had prepared for in advance. He sent his disciples into the village to collect the donkey for him. He must have made the arrangement for it earlier because he had many friends in the village of Bethany where they got the donkeys. The phrase, "the master needs them," was a password by which the owner would know that the hour which Jesus had arranged had come. So Jesus rode into Jerusalem. The crowd received him like a king. They spread their cloaks in front of him. They cut down and waved the palm branches. They greeted him as they would greet a pilgrim. They shouted, "Hosanna," which means "save now." This was the cry for help which people in distress addressed their king or their God. We may take Jesus' action in this incident were planned and deliberate. He was following a method of awakening man's mind, which was deeply interwoven with the method of the prophets. He entered Jerusalem with deliberate intention of cleansing God's house, as Judas Maccabees had done 200 years before, when Antiochus deliberately profaned the temple by offering pig's flesh on the altar. On that day, people carried palm branches and sang their psalms. It is almost exact description of the actions of the crowd who welcomed Jesus in Jerusalem. Jesus' entry into Jerusalem shows us his courage. He knew fully well that he was entering a hostile city, but he entered anyway. He was deliberately setting himself up in the center stage. He was calm, but sent the message that with him, it is all or nothing. Men must acknowledge him as king or not receive him at all. He showed that he came not to destroy, but to love, not to condemn, but to help, not in the might of arms, but in the strength of love. He was not a warrior king who came in the chariot of horses, but a peacemaker on a humble donkey. This event took place on Sunday. It is recorded in all the four Gospels. 3. The Kingdom Parables. Matthew 25, verses 1 to 13. Jesus was teaching in the temple on Tuesday. God, likened to a thief, is the element of surprise. God is God of surprises. In the first parable of the 10 virgins, verses 1 to 13, Jesus gives a slice of real life from a village in Palestine. It was directed against the Jews. They were the chosen people. Their whole history should have been a preparation for the coming of the Son of God. They ought to have prepared for him when he came. Instead, they were quite unprepared and therefore were shut out. They expected the Lord to come at their own time frame. But the parable has a universal warning. It warns us that there are certain things that cannot be obtained at the last minute. The parable is interpreted to refer to the second coming of Christ. Our own preparedness for the Lord can be a lesson for us here. To be too late is always tragedy. Just as the first parable focuses on unpreparedness, the second one teaches a lesson on laziness and reward from God for faithfulness, verses 14 to 30. This parable was directed towards those who build a fence around the law. Any change, development, alteration, or new thing is to them a problem. Jesus tells us that there can be no religion without adventure, and that God can find no use for the shut mind. He tells us that God gives men different gifts. It is not a man's talent that matters. What matters is how he uses it. The parable tells us that whatever talent we have, little or great, we must lay it at the service of God. It also tells us that God rewards work well done, but still expects more work to be done and more responsibility. He punishes the man who will not even try to use his one talent. It is the lesson of life that the only way to keep a gift is to use it in the service of God and in the service of our fellow man. His lesson here is crystal clear that God will judge us in accordance with our reaction to human needs. His judgment does not depend on the knowledge we have acquired about him, or the fame we have acquired, or even the fortune that we have gained, but on the help we have given. He teaches us that the help we give must be in simple things. Jesus picks out very basic things like giving a hungry man a meal or thirsty man a drink. How about welcoming strangers, cheering the sick, and visiting the prisoner? These are simple things anyone can do. It is not about giving out thousands of cash. It is a case of giving simple help to the people we meet every day. Actually, those who helped did not think that they were helping Christ and thus piling up eternal merit. They helped because they could not stop themselves from doing so. It was so natural, instinctive, and quite uncalculated reaction of the loving heart. The help that wins the approval of God is that which is given for nothing but the sake of helping. God is our great Father, and the way we delight his heart is to help his children, our fellow men. 4. Events in the upper room. These events might have happened on Thursday night. They are recorded in John chapters 13 to 17. This day was a day of fellowship with his disciples as he prepares them for his coming death. The Passover was a ritual week to celebrate. The purpose was not to fill the belly, but to remember the ritual of Exodus. Everything in the meal was meaningful. It reminded them of something that happened in the wilderness. But at this time, this feast typifies that the Lord Jesus Christ is going to be the sacrificial Passover lamb that will bear the sins of many and will redeem them from their bondage of sin. Things that happened here were: A. The washing of the apostles' feet. This is an act of servanthood. It was against the culture. Foot washing in the Jewish culture was a daily routine and was a gesture of hospitality. It was a lowly manual task reserved for the servants. When Jesus began to wash the disciples' feet, he took the posture of a slave. It is understandable that Peter protested Jesus' action based on his devotion to him. But we must understand that Jesus' act of service, such as washing feet and dying on the cross, provided an example of personal sacrifice to follow. When he said, "Wash each other's feet," Jesus might have intended a literal repetition of his act, or he might have seen it as a symbolic. Either way, Jesus wants similar servanthood spirit and sacrifice to characterize his followers. B. The promise of the Holy Spirit in chapter 14. Jesus assured his followers that they would not be spiritual orphans. He promised them that he would return to them, and while he's away, they will be filled with the Spirit who will sustain them with his presence. The Spirit continues Jesus' work by advising, defending, and protecting believers. see the teaching about the vine, chapter 15. Jesus prepared his disciples for his departure, instructing them to remain in a close fellowship with him. The image of the grapevine illustrates both intimacy and fruitfulness. What Jesus meant is, to sustain genuine spiritual life in the world, believers must remain intimately connected to Christ. Anyone who does not remain in Christ is separated from the vine and its life. Connection to the vine allows the life of Jesus to flow fruitfully through the disciple. Those who claim to be attached to Christ but produce no fruit are useless and will be burned. But true disciples will experience a transformed, fruit-bearing life because they will live in a relationship of love with both Jesus and the Father. D. The prayer of Jesus in John chapter 17. This was Jesus' longest recorded prayer. It provides an intimate glimpse in the heart of Jesus. In this prayer, Jesus expressed his own concerns to his Father and then turned to the concerns for the church and its future. Disciples of Jesus represent him. Their conduct and relationships with each other reflect the credibility of Christ in the world. When there is disunity, infighting, and intolerance, their testimony to the world is unconvincing. When people observe the community of believers, they know that it represents Jesus. A unified, loving community convinces the world to believe the good news of Jesus Christ. The community of believers should display the same glory that Jesus displayed from the Father. If the church lives in the Spirit, reflects the glory and love, and shows unity sustained by a shared knowledge of God, then its testimony will astonish the world. E. The Lord's Supper also took place in the upper room. It is categorically recorded in the Gospel of Luke chapter 22. This was after the ritual meal, which was a covenant relationship between God and man. God graciously approached man, and man promised to obey and to keep his law. The whole matter is set out in the book of Exodus chapter 24, verses 1 to 8. All the Jewish sacrificial system was designed to restore the relationship between God and man by offering of sacrifice to God to atone for sin. What Jesus said at this meal was this: "By my life and by my death, I have made possible a new relationship between you and God. You are sinners, but because I died for you, God is no longer your enemy, but your friend." It cost the life of Christ to restore the lost relationship of friendship between God and man. Jesus said to them, "Do this, and it will make you remember me." He knew how easily the human mind forgets. One sad note is that at the very table of communion, there was one who was a traitor. Jesus Christ has at every communion table those who betray him. If we pledge ourselves to him and then by our lives go out to deny him by our deeds, we too are traitors to him. After completing his farewell in the upper room, Jesus left the city and entered a garden just east of Jerusalem to pray. Here, he was arrested, taken under guard into the city, and interrogated by the Jewish leaders. 5. The crucifixion. This is one of the events in Jesus' life that is recorded by all four gospel writers. Before crucifixion, Jesus went through 6 trials, namely, 1. The trial before Annas, who was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, the high priest. Jesus asked why he is being asked about his ministry when it was plain for all to see. They struck him in the face. Annas was corrupt. The priestly livelihood made him corrupt. He made his money selling the sacrificial animals in the court of the Gentiles. Jesus had already closed his business down twice. Jesus' examination before Annas was a mockery of justice. 2. Trial before Caiaphas. This was an illegal meeting of the Sanhedrin, not in the temple, but in Caiaphas' house at night. Jesus is beaten here. Witnesses could not agree except that Jesus had promised to rebuild the temple. When forced to speak, Jesus clearly claims to be the Messiah. Caiaphas illegally tore his robes, accusing Jesus of blasphemy. All agree that Jesus should die. 3. Jesus is taken before the Sanhedrin at dawn in the temple to make the trial appear to be legal. They wanted a clear statement of Jesus' sin of blasphemy. They asked for it, and Jesus gives them what they want, a clear claim to be the Messiah and to be divine Son of God. 4. Then Jesus is made to appear before Pilate. This is when his civil trial begins. Since the Jews did not have the authority to execute a person, they needed Roman permission. Early in the morning, they brought Jesus to Pilate, who came out to meet them. Pilate did not really want to go ahead with the trial, but was obligated by the charges of political treason. Pilate spoke to Jesus and found him innocent. 5. Jesus brought before Herod. After that, Jesus was brought before Herod, who had the authority over Galilee, but was visiting Jerusalem at the time. He had heard of a rumor that Jesus is John the Baptist, who has come back from the dead. He was anxious to talk to him. He had no power to crucify Jesus. The worst Herod could do was to put him in prison, and that is not why Jesus came. Herod wanted to see a miracle done, but received only silence. Jesus, still found innocent, was sent back to Pilate. 6. Jesus before Pilate again. Jesus brought before Pilate again was mocked by Herod before being flogged by the Romans and then mocked again by the Romans. When Jesus was sent back, Pilate again declared him innocent. Pilate had Jesus flogged and offered to release him, but the crowd chose Barabbas, who was in prison as a rebel. The crowd demanded that Jesus be crucified. Pilate washes his hands and gives him up to be executed. One of the most wonderful things Jesus said while being crucified is, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do." Christian forgiveness is an amazing thing. There is nothing so lovely and nothing so rare as Christian forgiveness. When the unforgiving spirit is threatening to turn our hearts to bitterness, let us hear again our Lord asking forgiveness for those who crucified him. His servant Paul can be heard saying to his friends, "Be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ forgave you." Ephesians chapter 4, verse 32. Jesus' experience on the cross was a unique one. He did not die on the cross. He experienced death on the cross. When this happened, the natural laws of nature were suspended. Sun refused to shine. earth became unsteady, and there was an earthquake. Tombs opened, and the people came out alive. And the scriptures tell us that early on Sunday morning, what Jesus had told his followers many times happened. He had risen from the dead. Jesus' resurrection is a key pillar of the Christian faith. After his resurrection, he appeared to several of his disciples for a period of 40 days. Let us look at what happened during the 40 days between Jesus' resurrection and his ascension to heaven. Period 7, 40 days between resurrection and ascension. During this period, the Lord appeared to his followers at least 10 times. One can ask the question, why did Jesus appear for 40 days after his resurrection? One, to prove his resurrection to his disciples and critics. Two, to commission his followers. Three, to encourage his disciples. On his appearance on the road to Emmaus, he talked, corrected, and encouraged them. Four, to restore Peter. Five of the 10 appearances of Christ after resurrection are: one, appearance to two of his disciples on the road to Emmaus, Luke chapter 24, verses 13 to 35. Matthew 16, verses 12 and 13. 2, appearance to 10, Mark chapter 16, verse 14. Also Luke chapter 24, verse 36, and John 20, verses 19 to 25. 3, appearance to 7, John chapter 21, verses 1 to 25. 4, appearance to 11, John chapter 20, verses 26 to 32. And finally, appearance to 500, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 6. Significance of the resurrection. It guarantees our resurrection. The gospel system depends on it. Paul reasons that if the dead are not raised, then your preaching is in vain. Your faith and everything you believe is empty. There is no good news. 3, it is a proof of Jesus' destiny. 4, it is a basis of our justification. 5, it is a basis of the Christian hope. 6, it is a basis of the New Testament preaching. 7, it is the proof of Jesus' power over his and our enemies. The resurrection and the living witnesses of the church proves that Jesus is still our contemporary. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He is alive. Thank you for watching this series on the study of the life and ministry of Christ. I hope you have learned something useful that will help improve your spiritual walk with Christ.